Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Blessing to be in the house of the Lord again. We thank God for this, another privilege to come before you by way of the camera. He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In Him will I trust. To God be all the glory, the honor, and the praise. Blessed to be back here before you again today. We thank God for all He has done during the course of this week. Been somewhat of a long week, but we thank God that He had blessed us to make it to see another Sunday. What a blessing it is to know that our God is still in control. He's still in charge of the affairs of man. We still have an epidemic against us, and certainly we're hearing now that there's some spikes in different areas of the country. And so we are still going to be precautious at what we do. We'll take precautionary measures. We don't want to infect anyone. So at this present time, we're still going to keep doing what you see me do on YouTube. Let me make an announcement before I get ready to get into the message this morning. I'll be in the Old Testament. But on next Saturday, which would be, I think it's in July, would be the first Saturday, I believe, the superintendent of Sunday School will be on the parking lot. For those of you who still like to read your Sunday school lessons and Sunday school literature, our Sunday school superintendent will be on the parking lot on next Saturday morning around 10 o'clock, and he will pass out the Sunday school books if anybody desire to have one. He'll be here for probably about an hour or so, from around 10 o'clock to 11. Then if you want to run by the parking lot, our Sunday school superintendent will be on the parking lot to give you your Sunday school books and other literature that you may want to read over while you're at home. Amen. Still good to keep up with the Sunday school lesson. I've been reading mine and keeping up with them. And so you can come, and if you did not get your Sunday school book, he will be on the parking lot next Saturday morning, because today is the 28th. So next Saturday, he'll be out there on the parking lot. Amen. So we thank God for all He has done and that He's still going to do. We still pray for our sick and our shut-in. Amen. We pray in God will continue to bless them. Have a scripture for you today from the Old Testament book. I was studying, and I will start studying the book of Amos. Amos, Old Testament, one of the minor prophets. I want to look at that today. I still see some things that America, and perhaps even there are some church people who are not listening. They're just going on and hoping that things will get better. But until we heed the word of God and abide by His word of God and let Him see it in our heart, we're going to have a tight time trying to get back on the good side of God. Amen. Amen. So from Amos chapter 4, I hope you can find your Bibles there. Amos chapter 4. If you're looking at the Bible this morning, and if you're over there in the book of Obadiah, you're over too far. So come back one book. Amen. If you get up even to the book of Joel, I believe, amen, then go one more book over. The book of Joel, amen, J-O-E-L, go one book over, and there you will find the minor prophet Amos, amen. And I saw the verse here, matter of fact, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 verses there, it's pretty rich. But I'm going to read verse 6, amen, of Amos chapter 4, amen. And then we're going to pray and ask God to allow us to preach this message to you this morning, amen, because it's something I feel we need to look at. You know, we can always come to God with a large grocery list of what we want God to do, but God is saying He needs for us to do some things too in order for Him to bless us. So Amos chapter 4, minor prophet, Old Testament book. In verse 6, you'll find, I may read a couple of beyond that, but verse 6, God says this to the children of Israel, amen, amen. Matter of fact, in the last part of verse 5, He said, "O ye children of Israel, saith the Lord God." And He said, I also have given you cleanness of teeth in all your cities and want of bread in all your places. Yet have you not returned unto me, saith the Lord. And also I have withholden the rain from you when there were yet 3 months to the harvest, and I cause it to rain upon one city and cause it to rain upon another city. One piece was rained upon, and the piece whereupon it rained not with it. So two or three cities wandered unto one city to drink water, but they were not satisfied. Yet have you not returned unto me, saith the Lord. And he continues to say that. And the key to this thing, he said, I did all this for you, but you have not returned unto me. Amen. The title for this message is from Amos 4, verses 6 through 7 and 8. Amen. Unheeded chastisement. Unheeded chastisement. To break it down, I sort of put it like this. Anybody looking and listening, or anybody paying attention to what God is saying. Amen. Would you bow with me briefly? Father, we're again grateful for all that you have done, and we thank you for another blessed privilege that you have allowed us to come to sit behind this desk, Lord God, and preach your word to these thy children. Thank you, Lord, for another week journey, how that you blessed and kept us in your love, your divine care. Father, even when we went about our daily occupations, you suffered no hurt, harm, or danger to come before us. And God, we pause to say we thank you for being mindful of all of us. Lord, when I look at my situation, I say to myself, you're more mindful of me than I am of my own self. So Father, I have to pause to say I thank you, Lord God, for being mindful of me. And I know you're mindful of others, oh God, who call upon your holy and everlasting name. And then there are those, oh God, who don't even call you, yet they are receiving blessings as well. So Father, as we bow in Jesus, oh Lord, we thank you for Jesus, who made the way out of no way. Thank you for his birth, death, burial, and resurrection. Thank you, God, for rising on the third day morning, declaring that all power in heaven granted unto you. Thank you, Lord, for the gift of Jesus Christ, and because of the resurrection, Lord, because you live, we're able to live also. Father, would you forgive us of all of our sin? We pray for continued divine strength. Remain faithful, steadfast, unmovable to do your will. O Lord our God, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Before the mountain were brought forth, even thou hast formed the earth, thou art God. From everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Lord, you hold the reign of all of us in the palm of your hand, and you rule over this world. And God, we're in a troubled world. We're in an unrest world. Lord, I pray that thou would touch mankind everywhere. Have him to know, God, that you're still God, and beside you there is none other. Have that person who walked contrary, oh God, to know that the wages of sin is still death, but the gift of thee is eternal life through your Son, Jesus Christ. Oh Lord, as we bow in Jesus, Father, we pray now, God, that a word, Lord God, will come through this vessel, that somebody will hear, God, and somebody would look up, and somebody would pay attention to what's happening all in our world. Father, I pray in Jesus, Master, that you would grant me clarity of speech, which you bring back to memory that which you called me to study and meditate thereupon. And then, God, I pray that thou would let a listening ear hear. And, oh, God, let them hear and let them be able to hear what your words say. And not only just hear, God, but be a doer of your divine word. Father, let the words from my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in your sight. Lord God, my strength and my redeemer. For it is in the name of Jesus that I humbly bow, beg of you the blessing. All which we do pray, our soul says amen, amen. God bless you. Thank you for praying with and for us. And we thank God for this chance to share with you again from the Old Testament book today of Amos chapter 4, verse 6, which is our main part of our scripture lesson. Unheeded chastisement. Anybody looking and listening? Well, this morning, as I mentioned, I want us to look at the minor prophet Amos, who gained the attention of his audience by pronouncing judgment on Israel's enemies, before delivering the main burden of judgment against Israel herself. Amos the prophet lived in a time of great post-war material prosperity. The people thought that God had indicated his pleasure in them by giving them victory. They thought that everything was exactly as it should be. There were primarily only two classes of people in the day that Amos did this prophecy, and they were the very rich and the very poor, two types of people. The rich enjoyed great luxury and indulged in all the pleasure that money could provide. The poor were continually oppressed, and injustice was practiced in the courts. Don't you see some of that happening in our world? Injustice being practiced in the courts. True religion had been compromised to the extent that it was a mere form of religion. And the religion of the people produced no moral effect in their lives. In a time, a person can sit under the gospel and hear the word of God being preached and don't change, then something is missing. And he says here that there were no moral effects in their life when God's word was being proclaimed. The nations depended on financial and military might for existence among the nations of the earth. It seemed that all was right with the world. The prophet of God, however, was able to see signs of decay. Amen. Amos saw signs of decay, evidence of poison in the bloodstream, and inevitable calamities ahead of these people who were unable to read the signs of the time. I wonder if anybody looking and listening and seeing what's happening in our world. Amen. Divine chastisement was unrecognized and unheeded, Christian friend. God sent famine upon them. He says in Amos 4 and 6, which I read to you, I also have given you cleanness of teeth in all your cities and water bread in all your places. Amen. Yet have you not returned unto me, saith the Lord. Amos 4 and 6. God withheld the rain. In verses 7 and 8, he says, and also I have withholden the rain from you when there were yet 3 months to the harvest. Yet have you not returned unto me, saith the Lord. Amos 4, 7, and 8. And the reason I'm saying this is because of what I notice in news media, what I'm seeing. You know, it's really a hurting thing to see people continuously walk contrary to the will of God. Amen. We're asking people to practice certain things like distances and wearing the mask, and some of them feel I'm so invisible that, you know, I can't get sick. But you don't realize that this thing can hit you, and before you know it, you're checked out of here. Amen. The people said that thought back in Amos day that they had a drought when they didn't see any rain. Well, you know, it's just not raining when rain was needed. It did not come. Many people incorrectly assume that laws of nature takes care of such things as Amos is speaking about. You know, somebody forgot who controls nature. Amen. They thought, well, nature does this, and nature called the rain to fall, but they don't realize that it was God who controls nature. Amen, amen. In Amos 4, 9, God sent agriculture failure. He said, I've smitten you with blasting and mildew, when your gardens and your vineyards and your fig trees and your olive trees increase. He said, the palmer worm devoured them. Yet have you not returned unto me, said the Lord. I remember reading the story about Jonah when he had a pouting spell over Nineveh. Amen. And it was hot where he was, and what happened was that it was so hot until God caused a tree to come up over him, the shade on him, but Jonah didn't appreciate that, and so the palmer worm came and devoured the tree and withered away. You know, God got a way of getting our attention. I just wish somebody would listen to me. The people thought that the season had produced an unusually large number of insects. Many times, God is like a dentist. And he has to inflict pain that the better things may result. Amen. And I see some things happening in our world. You talk about the pandemic. You better recognize God has his hand in it. Amen. God chastised his nation with war. The people were so dull that they did not recognize that God was trying to tell them something. God says to them in Amos 4, verses 10 through 11, he said, I sent among you the pestilence after the manner of Egypt. Your young men have I slain with the sword, and I've taken away your horses, and I have made the stink of the camps to come up unto your nostril. Yet have you not returned unto me, saith the Lord. I have overthrown some of you as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah, and ye were as a firebrand plucked out of the burning. Yet have you not returned unto me, saith the Lord. And when I saw that, I said to myself, somebody ought to recognize when the Lord delivered you. Amen. When you were in your sin, or when things looked very dim around you, somebody should recognize who it was that delivered them. And you ought to say, thank you, Jesus, because it could be worse than what it is now. Amen. God wants somebody to see the chastening. God continues to chastise. God even chastises nations. The Christian, you and I, cannot study the Bible without recognizing that the Bible writers believed that God had the power to sway the destiny of nations. The God of grace and justice reward the nation that fear him and serve him, and punish the nation that ignore him and oppress the helpless. You know, God said, if you reverence me, I'm gonna listen to you. I'm gonna hear you when you call. But if you go your merry way and thumb your nose up at me as if I don't exist, God said, that's all right. I just stop right here and you work it all out. And you will find out that trouble or all types of calamities will be in your pathway. The study of history, saints, revealed that those who usurp the place of God and ignore the laws of justice and mercy are eventually destroyed. And you know what? God don't really have to do anything. You will destroy your own self. All you got to do is step out of God's grace and mercy and just say, I got it. I can figure it all out. And see how far you get. History has been described as his story. It's God's story. I can always remember how God would get me out of things. Been in some stuff in my life and sometimes didn't know how I'm going to get out. And all of a sudden, God made a way. I've had some things on this Christian journey that I didn't know how to figure it out. But God had already figured it out for me. And so I heed what God tells me, saints. And I learned a long time ago now not to walk off from God when he tells me, this is what I desire of you. And so I'm trying to get us to see, saints, please don't go off and don't heed the chastisement. The Bible declares, and history verified the truth, that in Psalm 9, verse 17, he says, the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all the nations that forget God. I don't want us to forget our God, although we're in the pandemic, but we got good memory, don't we? We got good history with God. We ought to remember where the Lord has brought us from. Always thank the Lord for what he has already done. There are nations today strutting across the stage of human history that must either change or experience the radical justice of a holy God. You know, I see this thing happening all around us. We got racism, we got the pandemic going on, but look like everybody is trying to figure it out on their own. I just wish somebody would consult God. I wish somebody would look up and say, Lord, help me to figure this thing out. You know, as I was studying this, I ran across a few examples that I want to share with you concerning chastisement. God chastises individuals. Let me give you a couple of them. As I was studying, what I'm talking about. That was said, that was a church member, not you all, was injured quite seriously while driving under the influence of alcohol. Notice I said he was a church member. His chest was crushed and his limbs were broken. His life hung by a narrow thread. Someone could have said that the accident was due only to the loss of his mental faculties while intoxicated. But the Christian don't put it off on things like that. When he came around and started feeling a little better, his explanation was different. After months of lying on his back, looking up, looking backward, looking inward, and looking forward with the language of faith, he told one of his friends that the loving Heavenly Father had caused him to have the accident to bring him to his senses. He rededicated his life and renewed his vows and resumed the discipline of discipleship. Sometimes God got to wake us up like that. Amen. When we callously go around and trample his grace on the sole of our feet. As the years went by, he became a trusted and respected servant of Jesus Christ, as well as a blessing to his family, his church, and his community. I wonder, is it anybody listening? Amen. You see, when you stop playing church, when you are real, somebody will know it. And there was another example I was reading in this book. Not the Bible, but I was doing some extra studying. There was an unbelieving husband and wife were blessed with the birth of a beautiful baby girl. The years went by. They refused to worship and bring the child to church. While still an innocent child, the girl became ill and died. Shortly thereafter, both the father and mother were converted and became faithful in both worship and work for God. They had to experience loss in order to experience the highest possible gain. Yes, they couldn't make it through this thing until they turned it over to Jesus. And I tell you, when the Lord chastises us, we ought to pay close attention. What is the purpose of chastisement? I mean, what does it need to be understood about it? Why do God allow certain things to happen? Why do God chasten us? Well, I start looking because I myself, Lord, I talk about how much you love me. I talk about how loving you are. But I also found out that God is not to be played with. Well, chastisement from God is the proof of the fatherhood of God. He says this in Hebrews 12 and 7. If you endure chastening, God dealeth with you as your son. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? In other words, God said, when you come to me, I've got to reprogram you. Matter of fact, I got to make change in you. You can't be like me and the world. I got to make a change in you. Where discipline is lacking, true fatherhood is wanted, because we are his sons and daughters. God chastises and educates us. I'm glad about what he did for me. In the distress and trouble of life, God deals with us in turn of his love. You see, God don't get a kick out of chastising us. God don't think it's fun to chastise us. But God sometimes shed a tear when he got a chastised an unbelieving child for whom the Lord loveth, Hebrews said. He chastened and scourges every son whom he received, Hebrews 12 and 6. God disciplines and chastises you and I according to the dictate of perfect wisdom, that we might be changed into the image of his holiness. That's why he chastises us. God wants to do something with us. He wants to make us in what he would have us to be. Furthermore,
Furthermore, we have had fathers in Hebrews 12, 9, and 10. Gonna pick up Amos in a minute. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and pleasure? Amen. For the Father of spirit and live rather. For they verily for a few days chasing us after their own pleasure, but our God chasing us for our own profit. You see, if we want to be blessed, we got to go through chastisement. Chastisement, properly understood and accepted, produces peace to be joyous, but grievous. Amen. No more chastening for the present seem to be joyous. Let me go back and do that again. Chastisement, properly understood and accepted, produces peace and righteousness. That's what I wanted to say. It produces peace and righteousness. Now, no chastening for the present seems to be joyous, but grievous. But look at here. Nevertheless, after it yielded the peace of a fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. You see, when you go through, something good comes out on the other side. Well, conclusion here, the psalmist saying, it is good for me that I have been afflicted, that I might learn thy statutes. In Psalm 119:71, God seeks people by means of his grace and goodness. The apostle Paul asks, despisest thou the riches of his goodness? Praise the Lord, and forbearance and long suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leadeth thee to repentance. I like that, y'all. God's goodness will lead me to repentance. In Romans 2:4, by the goodness of his love and by his mercy revealed in the gift of his son Jesus Christ. You see, God seeks us. What I mean by that, we didn't go looking for God, but God found us. He sent Jesus to die for your sin and mine. You see, he didn't have to said I just gonna do it, but God loved us so that he came seeking us. You remember Adam, don't you? Adam didn't go seeking the Lord when he sinned in the Garden of Eden, but God came seeking Adam. And just like God came seeking Adam, he's still seeking in Adam today. He wants to come and commune with you. If we turn a deaf ear and heart toward God's goodness, he may seek us through affliction and trouble. He uses this method only as a last resort to bring the greatest possible good to us after his entreaties of mercy have been spurned. Isaiah challenged each of us in Isaiah 55:6. He said, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Unheeded chastisement. I hope this morning that the Christian is heeding what's happening in our world. As the prophet Amos warned Israel of the coming chastisement from God because of disobedience to his word. Whether this world realizes it or not, see the plumb line of righteousness in America. And from where I stand, we are not plumb in our walk with our God. God is not leaning off the line, but we are leaning more and more to wrong rather than leaning to what is right. In the eyes of our God, let me tell you what will make it right again. As can I just say it one more time, in the book of Isaiah 55:6, he said, seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. And the Lord is near somebody right now. Am I right about it? God is saying, I want you to listen to me, because not only what we see now, it may get a little worse before it get better, but the God I serve, he is able to help you when you're down. I'm tell you, when things don't seem right, you ought to turn to the Lord and tell the Lord, I'm down here, Lord, and I'm waiting on you, and I can't do anything except you come. And oh Lord, sometimes I walk contrary to your will, sometimes I stumble along the way, but if you will, just come on in my life, come on in my life, and do what you have to do. If I'm walking contrary to your will, I need you, Lord, to put me on the right path. If I'm saying things contrary to your will, I want you to change my speech. If I'm not singing right, put the right song in my bosom. If I'm not shouting right, I need you to get in my step that I can shout right for you. Oh, yeah. Somebody, I need to shout a chastisement of the law and need to shame now. I heard not long ago a song was sung that it was not an ordinary service, but this ain't no ordinary message. It's one to tell us that we need to make a change. We're protesting. We're burning up cars. We're tearing down business. That don't make it right. But you ought to get on your knees and talk to Jesus and let the Lord know, Lord, that something is not going to make it right. I heard you say you can fight our battle, and God will. I said the Lord will. He'll fight your battle. If you turn it over to Jesus, he'll make it right. Won't he do it? He'll make it right in your life. So Amos said, yes, my Lord, I have given you cleanness of teeth in all your cities. And not only that, when you went for bread, I gave you bread to eat. When you were outdoors, I gave you a house to live in. When you were thirsty, I gave you water to drink. But nobody has returned unto me. So saints, let's turn unto God. Let's turn unto him wholeheartedly, and he'll make it right in all of our lives. May the Lord bless you now. Thank God for his word. Israel had turned their back on God. They said, well, you know, we ain't got no rain. That's because of nature. We got a drought. Pestilence all in the land. And they couldn't see that God was behind the scene. He said, I need your attention. I need you to listen to me. I need you to look up and see that I'm able to bless you. But you got to turn to me. And I heard an old person say one day, God ain't gonna bless no mess, but he will bless you with his goodness and mercy. So except we turn, saints, not only just Mount Zion, but all over this globe, we need to turn to God. We need to turn back to him and proclaim his goodness in our lives. And look, don't stop trying to play church. God know what's in our heart. We need to turn to God in our heart. I can fool folk with my phony shout. I can fool folk with my singing a lie. I can do all those things. But God look on the heart. Help me out here, Samuel. You remember when Samuel went to Jesse's house looking for a king for Israel. He looked at all the boys. Amen. Jesse had the boys to walk by. Samuel said, that looked like one. That's a good boy right there. He's tall, got good tall stature, stamina, muscular. And God said, no, Samuel, that's not the one I want. He said, by the way, Samuel, you're looking on the outside, but I, the Lord, look on the inside of his heart. And I tell by the way a man's heart is who I want to choose for my next king of Israel. And so God wants to see our heart right thing. Sure, we can put on the thing when we come to church. Sure, we can put on all the stuff and look good. But how is our heart looking on the inside? God wants to see the inside of us as pure as the outside. Jesus said on one occasion, sure, we make the outside the cup look good, but on the inside we're full of dead men bones. So saying, we want God to look at the inside of us, and we want God to know, Lord, we are real and we're genuine. And so I say you right today, please heed the chastisement that God has put upon us. And so until we heed what he's saying to us, we'll still stay in the pandemic. We'll still stay in the unrest with racism, all those things. Amen. God can change the worst man's heart in the world if we return to God. Don't worry about, you know, what president doing. Amen. You pray to God, ask God, Lord, help us and help him. Amen. And God will deal with him according to the book I've been reading right here. And so, saints, I submit to you this morning, let's heed the chastisement that our God put upon us. And sometimes, yeah, the just got to suffer with the unjust. But at the same time, know that God won't put no more on you than you're able to bear. And God is saying, my people, I need them to turn to me, and I can make it right. And you're blessed already. But listen, let's get a little closer to God. Let's get a little closer to him and let God work it out for all of us. Amen. Thank God for you this morning. I thank you for listening to me. Pray that someone said to prick your attention, to prick your mind. You know that we got a real God. We got a genuine God. He doesn't play with us. And God wants us to be real with him. May God bless you. I'm going to pray again for our sick and our shut-in. Amen. And continue praying for all of them that are sick, not able to go by the hospitals and nursing home because they still, you know, have the pandemic going on and they got restrictions. Try to abide by them, but that don't stop me from praying for our sick and our shut-in. I want to lift Brother Eugene Pinnell back in prayer again today and pray for him. And certainly I want to pray for the Jones family of Prospect, Virginia, over that Peace Baptist Church. This is a cousin of mine, Brother David Lewis Jones, slipped out of this world. Another friend of mine, Brother Crawley, amen, slipped out of this world. I went to school with him years ago, Brother James Crawley. I'm going to pray for that family. I will read me and others that are sick and shut in, especially for Mount Zion. I'm praying for us that the Lord continue to keep us strong. Mount Zion, I want you to stay faithful. Stay strong in your walk with the Lord. Sure, people will talk about you and chastise you, but you stay strong in your walk for God. Don't let nobody get you off course. Just hold on to Christ, and he'll make it right. Amen, amen. Bow with me. Father, in the precious and divine name of Jesus, our soon coming King, Master, I stretch my hand to you. Nor the help I know, Lord, if you withdraw thyself from us, whither, Lord, shall we go? Must Jesus bear the cross alone, all the world go free? No, there's a cross for everyone. Surely there was a cross for me. It's amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Saved wretch like me. I was lost, now I'm found. I was blind, thank God I'm able to see. Holy divine Father, in the divine name of Jesus Christ, I sit here with my head bowed, locks on my shoulder, praying, dear God, that thou would hear our prayer. Thank you, Lord, what you've already done. You blessed us with one more week. You kept us in your love, your divine care. That's worth saying thank you. When I think about what we could have been involved in, some of us could have been terminally ill. Some of us could have had COVID-19. But God, you spared us one more time. For that, we said thank you. Thank you, God, for watching over us every day, every night while we slumber and sleep. You touched us early every morning, allowed us to rise with a reasonable portion of health and strength. We could go about our daily occupation, day to day, routine. Kept some of us from seen and unseen danger. Thank you, Lord, for being such a good God. Father, as we bow, Master, we thank you even for such things as food, raiment, and shelter you're providing for us. Thank you, dear Lord, that there were no displeasures in our home this morning.
But there was somebody who had, Lord God, displeasure in the home. Death had invaded the ranks. You call some from labor to reward. God, I pray your blessing upon the bereaved families everywhere. Beg of you, God, that thou would touch them and have them to know that earth had no sorrow, heaven cannot heal. Father, I pray, God, for those, O Lord, who are sick on their beds of affliction. Would you bless Brother Eugene Pinnell, his daughter Irma Jean. I pray for Brother Sandy Hamlet on his way of recovery. Bless him, O Lord, and continue to keep him in your love. O God, all across this globe, some are sad, some are joyful. Lord, I pray that your peace will come into the saddened person's heart that will surpass their understanding. Let them find joy. Let them be able to hold their heads up and let them be able to dry the tears from their eyes and say, I know my Redeemer liveth, and I know that he's able to bring us through. Lord, I pray for the racism of this world. I pray, dear God, even for, Lord God, unrest, the pandemic. Would you continue to bless doctors, nurses, and those who are trying to find the cure. Give them the mind, God, to find that cure. Then, Father, I pray you put your arms around every church family. Bless Mount Zion this morning. Keep them in your love, God. Keep them strong, steadfast. They continue to walk and hold their head up and let the world know, sure, I still believe in my God. And nothing will separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Bless now, Lord. Thank you again, Lord. We love you and we praise your name. For it is in Jesus' name that we humbly bow. Beg of thee, blessed all participants, we do pray. Our prayer connect with others. Our soul says amen. Amen. God bless you. Once again, thank you for listening this morning. And this has been Pastor Lewis and Watch from the Mount Zion Baptist Church, Red House, Virginia. And also my son who is doing music for me, Brother Lewis and Watson, which is my music minister. We thank God for him as he come and share with us every time we are before the camera. May God bless you. I pray the Lord will keep you in your love and in his care. And my prayer to God that he may bless you again in your going and your coming in. May his grace be upon you, his mercy be your light. My prayer to God that he will always keep you and you stand with him and stand for him. God bless you until we meet again. Amen. Amen.